हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वी आर स्टडिंग द चैप्टर 18th सेंचुरी पॉलिटिकल फॉर्मेशंस एंड दिस इज द सेकंड पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। इन दिस पार्ट वील स्टडी द ओल्ड मुगल प्रोविंसेस। अमंग्स द स्टेट्स दैट वर कार्ड आउट ऑफ द ओल्ड मुगल प्रोविंसेस इन द 18th सेंचुरी थ्री स्टैंड आउट वेरी प्रोमिनेंटली। दीज थ्री वर अवध, बंगाल एंड हैदराबाद। All three states were founded by members of the high Mughal nobility who had been governors of large provinces. Saadat Khan was the governor of Awadh, Murshid Quli Khan, Bengal, Asaf Jah of Hyderabad. All three had occupied high mansabdari positions under the Mughal empires, enjoyed the trust and confidence of the emperors. Both Asaf Jah and Murshid Quli Khan held a Jat rank of 7,000 each, while Saadat Khan's Jat rank was of 6,000. So in this way, all these three were very powerful and highly positioned governors. Now, let's discuss about the first, Hyderabad. Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah, he was the founder of Hyderabad. State was one of the most powerful members at the court of Mughal Emperor Farrukh Siyar. He was entrusted first with the governorship of Awadh and later given charge of the Deccan. Deccan was the area, particular area. As the Mughal governor of the Deccan provinces, Asaf Jah already had full control over its political and financial administration, taking advantage of the turmoil in the Deccan and the competition amongst the court nobility. He gathered power in his hands and became the actual ruler of that particular region. Asaf Jah brought skilled soldiers and administrators from northern India who welcomed the new opportunities in the south. He appointed mansabdars and granted jagirs. He granted many jagirs to mansabdars. Although he was still a servant of the Mughal emperor, he ruled quite independently without seeking any direction from Delhi or facing any interference. So he did not face any interference from the Mughal emperor. The Mughal emperor merely confirmed the decisions already taken by the Nizam, means Asaf Jah. The state of Hyderabad was constantly engaged in a struggle against the Marathas to the west. From the west, Marathas used to attack, and with independent Telugu warriors, chiefs, who were called Naikas at that time, of Plateau. The ambitions of Nizam to control the rich textile producing areas of Coromandel Coast, which is the Coromandel Coast, that one on the eastern coastal region, Coromandel Coast. In the east were checked by the British, who were becoming increasingly powerful in the region. Here, the Nizam's army. A description of the Nizam of Hyderabad's personal troopers in 1790. You can read here. The Nizam has a sawari of 400 elephants, several thousand of horsemen near his person who receive upwards 100 rupees nominal pay, and are extremely well mounted and richly caparisoned. Now we'll study about Awadh. Awadh, the region Awadh. Burhan-ul-Mulk Saadat Khan, also known as shortly Saadat Khan, he was appointed Subedar of Awadh in 1722 and founded a state which was one of the most important to emerge out of the breakup of the Mughal Empire. Awadh was a prosperous region, controlling the rich alluvial Ganga plain and the main trade route between North India and Bengal. So you have to remember, dear students, Ganga plain, it means still it is very fertile area, and the area of UP and Bihar, this was the area of Awadh. And it was also a trade route, very important trade route between North India and Bengal. Burhan-ul-Mulk also held the कंबाइंड ऑफिसेज ऑफ सूबेदारी एज वेल एज दीवानी एंड फौजदारी, और इन अदर वर्ड्स ही वॉज रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर मैनेजिंग द पोलिटिकल मीन्स सूबेदारी एंड फाइनेंशियल दीवानी एंड मिलिट्री फौजदारी अफेयर्स ऑफ द प्रोविंसी ऑफ अवध. इट मीन्स ही वॉज वेरी पावरफुल, हैविंग द पावरफुल पोस्ट. बुरहान उल मुल्क ट्राइड टू डिक्रीज मुगल इन्फ्लुएंस इन द अवध रीजन बाई रिड्यूसिंग द नंबर ऑफ ऑफिस होल्डर्स, दोज हु आर अपॉइंटेड बाई द मुगल एम्परर्स, जागीरदार्स. ही ऑल्सो रिड्यूस द साइज ऑफ जागीर्स, मीन्स साइज ऑफ जागीर्स वर रिड्यूस्ड एंड अपॉइंटेड हिज ओन लॉयल सर्वेंट्स टू वेकेंट पोजिशंस. द अकाउंट्स ऑफ जागीरदार्स वर चेक्ड टू प्रिवेंट चीटिंग एंड द रेवेन्यूज ऑफ ऑल डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स वर रीअसेस्ड बाई ऑफिशियल्स अपॉइंटेड बाई द नवाब्स कोर्ट. ही सीज द नंबर ऑफ राजपूत जमींदारीज एंड द एग्रीकल्चरली फर्टाइल लैंड्स ऑफ अफगान्स ऑफ रोहिलखंड. सो इन दिस वे ही बिकेम पावरफुल by adopting specific policies. The state depended on local bankers and maharajans for loans. It sold the right to collect tax to the highest bidders. These revenue farmers, ijaredars agreed to pay the state a fixed sum of money. Local bankers means who guaranteed the payment of this contracted amount to the state. In turn, the revenue farmers were given considerably freedom in the assessment and collection of taxes. These developments allowed new social groups like moneylenders and bankers to influence the management of the state's revenue system, something which had not occurred in the past. So in this way, this was the management or the administration adopted by the ruler of Awadh, Saadat Khan. Now, this is about Bengal. Bengal gradually broke away from Mughal control under Murshid Quli Khan. Murshid Quli Khan was appointed as the Naib, deputy to the governor of the province. Although never a formal subedar, he was not a subedar, formal subedar, Murshid Quli Khan very quickly seized all the powers that went with the office, that office. Like the rulers of Hyderabad and Awadh, he also commanded the revenue administration of the state. In an effort to reduce Mughal influence in Bengal, he transferred all Mughal jagirdars to Odisha. This was the first step he had taken, and ordered a major reassessment of the revenues of Bengal. Revenue was collected in cash, first of all, you have to remember, with great strictness from all zamindars. As a result, many zamindars had to borrow money from bankers and money lenders. Those unable to pay were forced to sell their lands to larger zamindars. In this way, he got the power and became stronger. The formation of a regional state in 18th century Bengal therefore led to considerable change amongst the zamindars. The close connection between the state and bankers, noticeable in Hyderabad and Awadh as well, was evident in Bengal under the rule of Ali Wardi Khan, 1740 to 1756. During his reign, the banking house of Jagat Seth became extremely prosperous. Jagat Seth during Ali Wardi Khan. If we take a bird's eye view, we can detect three common features among these states, means Hyderabad, Awadh and Bengal. First, you have to note down, though many of the larger states were established by erstwhile Mughal nobles, they were highly suspicious of some of the administrative systems that they had inherited, in particular the jagirdari system. Second, their method of tax collection differed. Rather than relying upon the officers of the state, all three regimes contracted with revenue farmers for the collection of revenue. The practice of ijaredari, thoroughly disapproved of by the Mughals, spread all over India in the 18th century. Their impact on the countryside differed considerably. The third common feature, what was the third common feature in all these regional states, was their emerging relationship with rich bankers and merchants. These people lent money to revenue farmers, received land as security, and collected taxes from these lands through their own agents. It means they appointed their own agents. Throughout India, the richest merchants and bankers were gaining a stake in the new political order. The next topic is the Watan Jagirs of the Rajputs. What were the Watan Jagirs? Many Rajput kings, particularly those belonging to Amber and Jodhpur, had served under the Mughals with distinction. In exchange, they were permitted to enjoy considerable autonomy in their Watan Jagirs. In the 18th century, these rulers now attempted to extend their control over adjacent regions, means near about, connected to the particular areas. Ajit Singh, the ruler of Jodhpur, was also involved in the factional politics at the Mughal court. These influential Rajput families claimed that the subedari of the rich provinces of Gujarat and Malwa. Raja Ajit Singh of Jodhpur held the governorship of Gujarat, and Sawai Raja Jai Singh of Amber was governor of Malwa. These offices were renewed by Emperor Jahadar Shah in 1713. They also tried to extend their territories by seizing portions of imperial territories neighboring their watans. Nagaur was conquered and annexed to the House of Jodhpur, while Amber seized large portions of Bundi. Sawai Raja Jai Singh founded his new capital at Jaipur and was given the subedari of Agra in 1722. Maratha campaigns into Rajasthan from 1740s put severe pressure on these principalities and checked their further expansion. Here we can read this Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur description of Raja Jai Singh in a Persian account of 1732. Raja Jai Singh was at the height of his power. He was the governor of Agra for 12 years and of Malwa for 5 or 6 years. He possessed a large army, artillery, and great wealth. His sway extended from Delhi to banks of the Narmada. So in this way, this description is telling us that how Raja Jai Singh increased his powers and he was in powerful position. You can see this image, Mehrgarh Fort, Jodhpur, this fort. Dear students, in the next video, we'll study the topic, seizing independence.